Their participant of third Mom-led workshop 2021. I'm glad to see you here, and we today can already start our workshop. First of all, I want to
recording in progress.
Our scheduler for today. We sorry, moment. First of all, we work 40 minutes every hour. Start at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock. 1 o'clock we have dinner interruption, and from 2 o'clock we continue our workshop up to 6 o'clock if it will be needed.
Okay. Could you make your sound a bit more loud?
Once again, please, Alexey, don't understand.
Трошечки можно, трошечки голосніше.
Голосніше? Louder? Okay. I'm have a maximum. Okay, then let me give a word to Michael Emmerich from Leiden University. First, a report towards explainable artificial intelligence in optimization and network science.
Okay, I will share the screen, right? So let me share screen. Can you understand me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Do you see my slides?
Yes, me.
Yes.
Okay. Dobry den. Hello, good day. I'm happy today to have the opportunity to talk about the topic of explainable artificial intelligence and give a first presentation in this workshop, data science and machine learning, modern techniques. And this workshop is very interesting in the sense that we combine different topics of data science and machine learning, and also look at many applications of these topics. So I would like to introduce here a new trend that has emerged in the last years, that is to make artificial intelligence tool more human-centered and more easy to understand. So this is called explainable artificial intelligence, and it's mainly used for predictions and classification tools based on the deep learning, but I would like to give a perspective how we can use this also in other artificial intelligence tools, like in the analysis of complex systems and in the decision-making based on optimization. So why explainable AI? What is explainable AI about? So we have this new time where artificial intelligence becomes ubiquitous in everyday life. So more and more we see that our life is guided by AI tools. We have autonomous vehicles that are partly steered only by humans anymore. And we have navigation tools. We use them almost every day, traffic control. Then on a government level, we have public health management, like we see in this big Corona crisis. and climate change management, future problems that needs to be addressed. We have diagnostics, always a challenge to fight disease. And medical doctors more and more use artificial intelligence in their practice. And also security, cybersecurity, defense. We need to be. Sometimes we have to make decisions based on analysis of images using AI, but also make optimal planning using AI tools. Then there's this field of design, and this can be product design, design of machinery, and so on, industry. Also selecting products, finding recommendations for clients, what they might like you would like to have a house or looking for a new flat. What do you recommend to your clients? What is the optimal selection? What is the optimal design for a house, for instance? And then we have here all these AI tools that are now available, and we will use them a lot, and we already use them. So, and the problem is with these AI tools, they are very powerful, accuracy, but they are complex and intransparent. So we don't trust them. We think we are looking into a black box. These tools are often black boxes, or they are complex models that we are not able to grasp what is happening inside of them. Even we are an expert, we are struggling with all these equations and understanding what's going on. And we have to trust these models. And a good example is deep learning. Big hype in the last years. It's very powerful. We know it can analyze images to an extent we never there before. It can play games and so on. It's based on big data and neural networks. And the thing about deep learning is that it's very intransparent. So I guess that the rise of deep learning models was the incentive for the explainable AI as a need in the AI community. So we wanted to add explanation for deep learning tools. So explainable AI seeks to add explanations or replace non-transparent models by models that can be understood and revised by humans. So I will talk more about the nuances of this field. It has been first mentioned explainable AI in a paper related to defense, where military had to make some justification for certain targets, and it was done by DARPA, Gunming David. And in a research project, there was a kind of outline of this need, explainable artificial intelligence in responsible decision making. And XAI trend is increasing. There has been always attempts to explain your to explain to humans in expert systems some of the different decisions that you make, but this focus on XAI is recently increasing much. And you see that 2017, there were almost no papers on it. In 2019, it was the main trend in interpretable techniques. And we see here a rising trend in recent years. So I think this is something to look at in the future when we work in data science, a future topic. And my next slide is about the understanding of the four principles of explainable AI. So what is explainable AI? We can understand it by looking at the four principles. So one, these principles have been mentioned in the often cited report by Phillips et al. NIST report that is open available and a bit high level, but they give a good summary of what XAI is about. So it's about explanation. An XAI system should offer explanation, meaning we should give evidence, but also reasons for all outputs that we produce with an AI tool. It should be meaningful. The system should provide explanations that are understandable to human users. So human-centered, you can also say here, that we think about how do the expert or the human that we are addressing understand this information. Explanation accuracy is very important. So what is the level of accuracy we give here to the humans, decision makers? So is it often replacing XAI systems, replacing the traditional deep learning systems, makes a trade-off. There's a trade-off that we have less accuracy. So we should aim still for very high accuracy of our models and also express the limit. This is something a bit neglected in giving explanations. You can also explain what you know and explain what you don't know based on the data given and based on the model limitations. So this can be taken into account when building an XAI system. And then there are different XAI systems proposed, and recently this field is not yet consolidated, so there are still a lot of ongoing work in definitions and very basic definitions. I like very much this very basic distinction between two types of explainable AI systems. One is the model-centric explanation, and the other is the subject-centric explanation. So the model-centric explanation seeks to explain the entire model. Say you have a deep learning model, and you want to replace it then by a model that is also doing a prediction and is almost as accurate as the deep learning model in that case, or the black box model. So in that case, you trade off a bit the accuracy, but you make it much more easy to explain. For instance, you can think of a decision tree model that is replacing a deep learning model, but you use the deep learning model to train this decision tree model and to check it for its accuracy. Do the best effort in this simpler and easier to understand model. Okay, replacing models is one thing, and developing interpretable modeling techniques. The other technique is a subject-centric explanation that seeks for local explanations. So here we focus on the specific query. So we want to, for instance, classify a specific and want to know which bird is on this image. I will show an example later. Or we want to look at a specific image of a patient as a medical doctor and want to know what kind of disease or, for instance, cancer we see here on this image. And we know much about the patient, and then the explainable AI system will not only classify this image, but it will also explain for this specific case why it comes to the conclusion. Of course, this will be an easier task than the model-centric explanation, because we can focus on this specific query and leave out all the information that is irrelevant for answering this query. Maybe it is also more easy to quantify the certainty that we have about the answer if we have a specific query. So this is discussed in a paper called Slave to the Algorithm, which is a bit critical to explainable AI, because it's not the remedy for all the problems that we have in artificial intelligence. There are also privacy problems and so on. So explanations don't remove all the problems, but it is a very interesting add-on to artificial intelligence tools. Okay, let us look at explainable AI in different forms. So I have given this broad classification in the previous slide on model-centric and subject-centric explanations. Now I would like to give a bit more detailed view that I would like to give on different systems of XAI. So you can look at the following aspect that you just use a model that is inherently explainable. So this would be this model-centric AI approach. So you decide to develop a technique like a decision tree model that you can easily interpret, or rule-based model. But you can also replicate a black box model. So not completely replacing the black box model, but use both the simple model and the black box model in combination. So for the explanation, you use the other model, and you have also the accuracy check, where you use the more complex and more black box, but powerful deep learning model, for instance. So you use two model combination and use one model as a kind of check. And then there's another system that you can use, models that allow local explanation, that I already mentioned, the subject-centric models, but you can also think of a local model. So say you have a specific query, and in this query you ask for a specific type of information, and for this a local model can be replace the global intransparent model. Actually, the complete replacement of intransparent models by transparent models is already a topic in interpretable AI, where the focus is to develop these models. So this is a longer history topic in the artificial intelligence domain. But these combinations of intransparent model and transparent model, as well as the local explanations, these are the new topics in explainable AI in addition to this. And then I would like to also mention that we not only explain the output, but we can give additional information to the output. Think of the following situation. You make a classification and of a disease, for instance, based on a picture. And you can give a bit more information on how this, how certain you are about this, for instance, not only make a classification, but also a kind of uncertainty quantification. And maybe also say, based on which data you came to this conclusion, and so on. So which in optimization later, we will see which variables were important to come to this conclusion, and so on. So you give a richer picture than just output one result from the black box, much more information that gives the user also more, more feedback on the result. And for instance, when you talk to a patient as a doctor, as a medical doctor, you often already do this. This would be, you tell not only this is a disease, but I think so because of this and this. So you not only give a diagnosis, but you give this explanation and also maybe some remarks about how you come to this conclusion. And this is interesting information as well. So far, XAI was used in classification and computer vision. So this is the main application of XAI. So we want to understand objects. We want to classify them. We want to interpret images, for instance, or data. So this application is, in my opinion, not the only one where we should use XAI. I work in the field of multi-objective optimization and complex system models. And I think also in these fields, we have these problems related to black box predictions and black box producing solutions to problems. For instance, we come up with a timetable based on a multi-objective optimization model or on a design, and we propose this is the best design. But why is it the best design? So we should explain this, that the human designer can gain some trust in this design and also can be able to explain why this is a good solution with respect to certain objectives. And then I also would like to propose for future research more attention to complex system models. We use often complex simulations of the future or of systems in order to come to scientific conclusions. And it is often very difficult to explain these conclusions to the general public. There's, for instance, the ongoing debate, is climate change really happening? Well, or is there, some people even doubt that there's a coronavirus. They say it's just some hoax. But of course, these are maybe easy examples. You can easily argue why you think this is the case. But it becomes more difficult if you suggest certain measures that have to be taken and that they are meaningful. And then as a scientist, you might understand the complex model and all its assumptions, but you need to explain it to people who are not scientists. And in that case, what you would need is a more heuristic explanation. So a simpler model that is still very close to the truth. And again, need for explainable AI to not replace a real black box model, so it's a model understood by some domain experts, but to make the complex model simpler and add explanations to decisions and make them this way more, you can disseminate this knowledge better to a broader public. And I think there's obviously a need for such techniques. Also for scientists to show their results to people and explain them. Okay, we have the current state of the art, much focusing on topics like image analysis and classification, also in financial, like creditworthiness or in medicine. There's lots of work going on in explainable AI, and here's just an example showing you how such an explainable AI system could work and that there are different kinds of explanations. So here we see a little bird, the cardinal that lives in North America a lot. And it's a very nice bird, very easy to classify, by the way. It's red and there are not so many just red birds, but you can think of it as an example just. Why is it a cardinal? So it might be another red bird. There are some, like a flamingo, for instance. And I want to show how such a system could work. This is an example from this paper, Explainable AI, the new 42. And they say that an explanation can be such that it's some text. For instance, it has a bright red beak. So this is a reason why it is a cardinal, why we come to this conclusion. So we use some text, natural language, but we can also point to some features in the image that we think are important to identify this bird. And who of you does bird identification knows that we always, as an expert, would look at certain features and then say, yes, this is this particular type of bird. And of course, in other domains, it is a similar story. We look at certain parts of the data that make us come to the conclusion. And then it's also interesting that you can use explanations that highlight certain parts of the data, which is not text explanation, but more showing subsets. So this is the topic. You can read much now about this, explainable AI for classification. I would like to talk now in the remaining time about the outlook into other applications of explainable AI, like in planning problems and also in complex system problems. And this is more like an outlook. So there can be much more work on this. And I have first ideas how this could be shaped. So let me share some of these ideas. Explainable AI for multi-criteria decision analysis. So what is multi-criteria decision analysis in a mathematical abstract way? We have multiple functions that we would like to optimize, and they depend on variables. So these variables could denote a timetable, or they could denote some planning or design, like a parameterized shape. And you have different target objectives that you would like to get as big as possible or as small as possible, like some design variables like energy consumption, cost, and so on. And then we have constraints, and we have to keep within these constraint limits. And often we don't know exactly where to put the limit, but we give here some numbers, and we can sometimes allow to relax a bit these constraint limits. And constraints can be also modeled as black box functions. And I think of them as also intransparent black box functions that might require explanations. And if we have multiple objectives, they can be in conflict with each other. So for instance, if we minimize the pollution of an industrial process, we might have to pay more for this cleaning processes, and the cost will be higher. So we cannot minimize at the same time both, but there will be a trade-off. And there will of course be dominated solutions that are bad in both aspects. But then we can express our preferences. So what are the more important things to us and what are the less important things to us? And there are various techniques in artificial intelligence and in multi-criteria optimization, how to express preferences. And often it's done by weights. So I will be not specific here, but I can imagine this preference model as a utility function that we maximize. So it depends on these function values and on some weights that we put on these function values. And here is just a description of these functions. Let's consider them all as either very complex functions that we are not able to fully understand, or black box functions. What kind of explanations could be useful in optimization? We have seen the example of classification. And here in optimization, we have very different types of explanations. For instance, we can have explanations that describe the output, output as a function of the input. But looking at this optimization problem, it is about improving certain outputs or getting worse in certain outputs. For instance, we might have discover that a certain ratio is very important to improve F2 and worsen F1. Let's assume this ratio here is something that the engineer is understanding, or the system designer, and then we can see what is the effect of changing this. And we can discuss it with a team of engineers. This ratio, can we do something about it? Or it's good to know that this is a very important ratio. So we understand what influences the objectives and in the input. Then secondly, we might want to understand or explain if certain constraints were decisive in establishing our optimal solution. So for instance, is a constraint active? Is it causing the solution not to become better? For instance, when we relax the constraint boundary C1, will we improve F1? And we can explain this. Currently, we cannot get better solutions in F1 because we have this constraint in C1 that is blocking F1 to get better. This could be a very easy to understand constraint. It's a local explanation. Then we have explanations on the dependence of the preference weights. This is something that is more to the user. When a user makes these preferences in terms of weights, we can come up with an optimal solution for this particular user. But then we can explain, because you express this particular preference by your weights, for instance, that you like to reduce pollution and you find this very important and not so much care about the cost. This is why safety is good for both solutions. And then we have here, so this is my perspective on optimization, that we have these different types of explanations that are really inherently related to optimization problems and their solution, not to classification problems. And a first example that we did in our laboratory in Leiden and Eindhoven, where we since many years focus on using artificial intelligence to improve the design of buildings with respect to disciplines, energy consumption and spatial performance, which is more stability related. We have developed a toolbox, and in this toolbox, you can come up with optimal designs for buildings with respect to various disciplines and objectives. And this toolbox we now extend also with respect to daylight performance, because light is very important also in buildings. And we can add also some constraints by the architects on aesthetics and so on. So these are building designs produced by the toolbox, and we can extend them to full buildings. But basically we are interested in the internal structure of the building, the walls inside the buildings, and the general shape of the building. And we have certain constraints about the volume of the different spaces in the building. And then we come up with Pareto optimal solutions. So the outcome of a multi-objective optimization is a trade-off curve that has win-win solutions only, but there's trade-off between them. But we don't have lose-lose solutions that are solutions you can improve in all objectives. So here's one objective, it's the structural compliance, which should be minimized to avoid stress in the wall of the building, which leads to cracks and instabilities. And secondly, we have the energy consumption that should be minimized, so we don't want to lose energy or get too hot in summer. So this is the objective, second objective, and then we have a trade-off optimal front. We computed it in a, with many various designs. These are the canola in both objectives, the so-called Pareto front, and we see here different regions in our produced data set from the optimizer. So we see this region that we have very good compliance buildings. So the structural performance is very good. Then we have the knee point solutions, I will comment later. We have here good thermal performance, very low energy loss. And here we have the solutions that are bad in both. We are also in optimization interested what we should avoid, we should definitely not do. So low quality solutions, then we can compare them to high quality solutions. And this is a good compromise, a so-called need point, and where both compliance and energy consumptions are. Now we would like to add an explanation to this data generated by our optimizer. And in order to do this, we do some data explanation technique. We decision tree here, so it's a model-centric approach. And we feed the decision tree with human or designer understandable features, which are ratios between different sizes, the length of the building and so on. We made a large number of features, handcrafted them together with the engineers, what they want to understand. And these features are then used in a decision tree that can guide us to different regions on the Pareto front. And we come from this to different explanations optimal solutions, like long buildings are structurally efficient, which is
Michael, you have 3 minutes left.
Okay, I will be almost.
Okay.
And less long will have a mortgage, and that is indicated by the knee point. So we have a kind of idea how to build good structures. And my second example, I will then cut a bit short. So here in the complex systems, I want to say that we have often models that have complex behavior, and we need to explain certain things about these models to people who don't understand all this complexity. And this can be, for instance, climate change models, biological system models, or the outbreak of an epidemic, which is an example that I put here. And we have a later talk on this, and nonlinear market dynamics in societal transitions. So understanding markets behavior or understanding how society is changing is also something that we would like to communicate to a broader public and make them understand these changes, but also the models are normally very complex. And then we have complex models it's not easy to see the cause and effect relationship because of feedback loops. And we have lots of difficult to understand effects like exponential rise or exponential decay as opposed to linear effects, and so-called butterfly effects, that small effects get much amplified, and bifurcation, tipping points, and so on. And then we can also here use explanations to point to the most important facts that may explain the system and what we have to look at in the system to get a good understanding that helps us to motivate some strategies, how to, for instance, control the system or manage it. You will see in a later.
Yeah, Dr. Emmerich, we should restart because now Zoom will interrupt us.
Okay.
Okay, we should restart now Zoom.
Okay, good. The